Okay, welcome to the second lecture for Scoring for Interactive Media. This is the content that you'll be looking at during week two, and the topic for today is analytical listening techniques. And so the first question is, what is musical analysis? And a short answer is that it's the study of musical structure. And you can think of that as the way in which music is put together by a composer. And the study of musical analysis addresses how a composition or a piece of music is constructed from the basic elements that comprise it. And you can think about this as sort of like the Lego bricks that construct a piece, a large object or a piece of music. So we're going to be thinking about the Lego bricks that comprise composition. And the steps of musical analysis always begin with something that we call discretization or segmentation, meaning to take the long stream of sound and break it into its constituent parts so that you can analyze and attend to the different sections individually. And this requires attending sensitively to one's own perceptions and hearing, and to take seriously the sounds that you're processing, and to not just let them wash over you, but rather to attend to them and figure out how they're put together. So this process of analytical listening is really a process of working against the natural instincts to just let sound passively wash over you, to bathe in it, to relax into it. These are very natural tendencies because, of course, that's what music is for us to enjoy the aesthetic experience of it. But analytical listening requires a kind of conscious forcing of one's conscious mind to attend to the components in the music so as to better understand them. And what you're really doing is identifying the sound features in the music and interpreting them and figuring out how they relate to each other. The same way that you might look at a great piece of architecture like the Parthenon and figure out, okay, so it has this many columns and they're arranged this far apart and the material is marble. So in the same way, we think about the components and constituent parts of music. And it's a long list, so bear with me as I list all of the ideas, all of the different ways of thinking about how music is put together. And the first idea about this is the idea of a motive, which is a short musical utterance, usually just a couple of notes, and it's really the shortest, three, four, five notes, shortest duration, almost like a musical icon. It allows you to identify something and recognize it when it comes back. So it's the shortest possible grouping of a musical idea. A longer grouping is called a theme, and a theme is really musical material that provides a sense of identity, usually containing a recognizable melody and perceivable as a complete musical expression in and of itself. And we've already talked about themes with regard to leitmotif. Leitmotif is a special application of theme where the theme represents a human character in a drama or in an opera, or as we saw in Star Wars. Also, there's this notion of character. So character are components or qualities of a section of music that make it identifiable. And you can think about character features such as rhythmic character. It might be very bouncy and energetic, or it might be very calm or lethargic. Character might be sprightly. There may be lots of huge transitions in soft and loud. Or there may be lots of jumping around in pitches, or maybe the pitches are very more linear and stepwise. So these are some of the ways that we describe the character of music that make it recognizable and make it sound like a cohesive idea. Style is the groupings of those features together that are culturally relevant. You can think of style as the comparison between EDM and house and hip-hop and disco, but you can also think about style in terms of human culture and human history. You can think of Western classical music or Hindustani classical music in the Indian tradition. There are so many different styles of music that humans have participated in over thousands and thousands of years. And really, when you're identifying a style or describing a style, you're recognizing that there are individual groupings of features that are culturally consistent and that certain subcultures prefer. And so these stylistic decisions are really decisions about belonging to a group. You can also think about rhythm. And the way rhythm is defined is that rhythm is the patterning of pulses and silences. What is a pulse? A pulse is a moment of implied heaviness or down, ictus. Rhythm is defined by these moments of heavy and light. So this is a pulse, and then this is the liftoff of the pulse. So we have heavy, light. And those patterns of pulse and the duration and width of those pulses and the separation between them and the ways in which those durations are changed, that can create a sense of rhythm. Rhythm can have great density, rhythm can have great complexity, it can be simple, it can be slow, it can be fast. So there are ways in which we think about rhythm as a usage of time and the emphasis of pulse and lightness. Frequency, which I probably should have listed first on the slide, frequency we can think of as pitch. Pitch is the stair-stepping of the frequency space. Frequencies are continuous. Frequencies, you can sing a note continuously from da, right? Or you can carve up the stair steps and go do, 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 do. And so frequency is the range of speeds of oscillation or vibration in a sound. And pitch is the stair steps that have been carved out to kind of discretize the individual frequency bins. And some of the qualities that we associate with frequency include register, which is the perceived highness or lowness of the pitch, or the contour, when you group a few frequencies together, what sort of a shape does it make? Does it go up and then down? Or then does it sort of progress one way or the other way? So contouring frequencies can tell a story. We can also think of melody, which is the grouping together of several notes together. And usually it has a beginning, a middle, and an end, maybe sentence length, the length of a vocal utterance. And then we have the vertical arrangements of frequencies, harmony and harmonic progressions. And really what that means is we're layering multiple frequencies one above each other simultaneously and counting the distances between. And in Western tonal harmony, we have very fixed relationships there. We define major and minor, tonic and dominant. And we have all sorts of ways of identifying what type of harmony is currently playing. And then a harmonic progression is a sequence of harmonies that are put one after another to create a sense of storytelling. And finally on this slide, envelope. So envelope is the way that a single note evolves over its duration. And in Western music theory, we call that articulation. It's the way that a note starts, sustains, and ends. In electronic music, we have a term for this. We call it ADSR, which refers to the outer amplitude envelope of the note. And the acronym stands for attack, decay, sustain, and release, meaning the way a note ramps up from silence, the initial sagging of the volume right after the attack, that's the decay. Then the sustain is how long the note sits there on a steady state. And then release is as the note tapers back down to silence, the shape of that. And those four phases of the envelope describe the way that the note evolves. And in Western classical music, we think of articulation as staccato versus legato, so short and spiky versus long and elongated. And so we can use all different ways of thinking about articulation or envelope, and whatever works for you is fine, as long as it helps you conceptualize what is happening in that moment in the music. Okay, here's the second slide for the components of musical structure. The first element is timbre. Timbre is a French word. It means tone color. And the way it's usually described is if you listen to three different instruments playing middle C, all one at a time, the difference between those three sounds is timbre. And timbre is a complex concept. It combines both articulation with overtones, and basically the individual overtone spectrum of the particular instrument that's playing the sound can very much determine timbre. So we often associate timbre with the instrumentation, let's say French horn versus trumpet versus flute, These are obviously instruments, and each instrument has its own timbral signature, and timbre is therefore an important component of any piece of music that you might compose. There's also intensity, which you can think of as volume or amplitude, or if you're a classical musician, you can think of it as dynamics, the difference between loud or forte, soft or piano. And this intensity is yet another aspect in the composer's toolkit that they can use to modify the perceived intensity or the perceived heaviness or emphasis of a particular moment in music. The next term is layers. And what I mean by layers is most of the time we don't have just a single instrument playing. Most of the time there are a few, at least a few or sometimes many instruments all contributing to the whole. And conceptualizing how the layers have been put together, how many layers there might be, whether those layers are very similar to each other or very distinct from each other, whether there's a perception of density, are they all bunched up together in the mid-range, or are they spaced out, are they super low and super high with not much in the middle? All of these kinds of decisions and the relationships between the layers can affect very significantly the quality of music. You know, solo versus small groupings versus larger groupings. If you think about the orchestra, when the strings play by themselves, that's one, that could be one layer, but it's also one layer that itself is comprised of four or five layers. If the winds play, you can think of it as one layer, but it's really a complex combination of several instruments together. So the balancing and orchestration and the choice of instruments and layers and how they're all put together creates this notion of texture. And you can think of texture as if you were looking at a wonderful tapestry in a museum, and you can see all the different threads all woven together, each one a different color, creating this lovely image. So texture is the same idea. You have all these different musical layers all interacting and intersecting with each other. And so the texture of music can be thick, thickly textured or densely textured or light and sparse, depending on what the composer wants to express at that particular time. So layering is a very important technique. Also similarly, repetition. Repetition you can think of as creating a sense of overall architecture or form. As I mentioned earlier, you can think about the Parthenon and the spacing of the columns, and that the number of columns and their relationship to each other creates that sense of architectural form. But the same thing is true in music. If you can think about a motive or a theme being played at the beginning and then coming back to it and coming back to it at various times throughout the piece, those repetitions are usually chosen for a very specific reason, and those individual repetitions you could think of as the individual columns that construct the overall shape of the building. And so repetition can be a very important tool to create that sense of beginning, middle, and end, and the scope of the work. Also, energy. This is something that I like attending to. I like to think of it as a sense of momentum, as being propelled through the arc of the piece. And you can think of energy as providing direction and intensity, or a sense of gravity or effortfulness or weight. So if you think about a piece of music and it's light and zippy and energetic, it's sort of a high, quick energy. Whereas if you feel like you're wading through molasses, that's a different kind of energy, maybe equally effortful, but maybe not getting so far. Or you could have low energy, or different kinds of energy states, and transition between those states to create a sense of direction. Also transitions. So you can think about transitions as the moments when you go from one musical idea to another. And there are a lot of decisions that you can make at that point. You know, do you want to do a crossfade, or do you want to fade one out and then bring the other one in and have no overlap? Do you want an abrupt transition or a smooth transition? You can think about in EDM, the drop is a famous example of a transition where suddenly the floor falls through and you're totally transformed into a new place. So the choices that you make around transitions can really impact the way that your music sounds and is experienced. And finally, the last two, the big ones, emotion and storytelling. So as I mentioned earlier in class, emotion is one of the key elements we think about why music exists at all. And certainly composers, great composers, can deeply affect our mood as audience members. And many people think that the way that moods are affected is in patterns of tension and resolution that are set up. And these things are culturally constructed. But the idea being that if you sense certain kinds of dissonance or certain kinds of unusual combination, that those can create a sense of tension in the listener that is then resolved by signaling that we're returning to some sort of sense of steady state or homeostasis. And so this use of tension and resolution is critical for the arc of the story. And overall, in storytelling, music can be very helpful in emphasizing certain elements in the plot and in the story structure by either getting really heavy or adding all the instruments all at once, or lightening up the texture when maybe there's a moment of sadness or contemplation. So music in all of its many, many components can aid in the storytelling, in the visual narrative. Okay, so now I'm going to present three different ways to think about analyzing music, and these are designed to be replacements for having to read a score or having to read musical notation. So all three of these methods can be deployed without any knowledge of music theory, simply from attending to sound. And the first one is called active listening. And this is a technique that I borrowed from psychology, psychotherapy. It's a communication technique used often in counseling and training and conflict resolution. And active listening is used as a way of listening and responding to another person that improves mutual understanding. And we can, of course, apply it to music and make it musical understanding. When you apply it to music, active listening is a structured form of listening and analysis that focuses on attention to the sounds directly. And I often associate active listening techniques with a composer named Pauline Oliveros, who was an electronic music pioneer. She recently passed away, sadly, but her institute still lives on. It's called the Deep Listening Institute, and they're located in upstate New York. And they really use these principles of active listening, almost like meditation, as a way to really deeply engage with the creative process. So the steps for active listening include three. There are three steps. The first step is comprehending. So to listen attentively without any distractions or other thoughts intruding, and to resist the tendency to formulate a response or an opinion, to do it without response, but attending to the sounds fully so that you absorb them and understand them. Step two is to retain those sounds in memory, the idea being that you can almost construct a complete image, almost like reading it in on your computer, that you can kind of retain the sounds in your memory and fully capture the shape of the whole piece from beginning to end in one kind of file in your brain. And step three is formulating a response. So the process of responding is to restate and describe what you've heard in your own words and to confirm the structure and form of what you've heard, in other words, what the composer has said. And you don't have to agree with or even like the sounds you've heard, but you simply have to echo them back. That's the goal, is you simply restate or repeat in as closely as you can what you have heard. And this process is very good for just really comprehending, trying to put yourself into the mental, into the brain of the composer, and really try to, I suppose the other analogy would be standing in their shoes, you know, to really sort of put yourself into the composer's brain and try to understand the work as it was constructed. A second technique is called procedural listening, and this is kind of fun. This is an extension to the idea of active listening, but in this case, informal structural analysis is basically narrated in real time. So as you're listening to the work, you're either writing down your thoughts and noting the time, or you're talking over the music and you're trying to understand it as it's flowing by, as if you were sort of canoeing down a river and you're noting all of the turns in the river or the rocks or the water splashing. You're sort of writing down and attending to and noting all the things as the river flows by. And one of my teachers was an expert at procedural listening. His name was Marvin Minsky. And there's a great BBC interview where he does a procedural analysis of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And I'll play just a minute or so of it for you now, and I'll make this audio file available on Canvas for you to listen to later. So here we go. Here's Marvin doing some procedural listening.
The fourth movement of Beethoven's Ninth seems like a story to me. And there are the basses. What are they trying to say? In this beginning of the movement, he gets an idea, and then these double basses come and interrupt it and say, oh, you're too busy for that. Now, this is the way the symphony began. This is where Beethoven practices tuning the orchestra. It's not really a symphony, it's an orchestra tuning up to prepare for the symphony. But those basses, they're interrupting again. Maybe he has another idea. Oh, that's really cheerful. In fact, that's the second movement.
Stop it there, and you can listen to the rest later on. The third and final technique we're going to talk about today is called musical flowcharting. It's a technique that I think I may have coined the term, I'm not exactly sure, but it comes out of the tradition of visual score notation by composers such as Varese and Stockhausen, where they created their own score notation using color and shape instead of notes and durations. And the idea behind musical flowcharting is that we basically group the sounds, the sections, into little symbols that represent something structural about the components in the music. And then, like a necklace, we string together this necklace of pearls or components to show how the music is put together structurally. And as you'll see, it's kind of fun, and it helps you in retrospect to look at the alternation of the different shapes and colors and to start to realize, like that Parthenon, how the music is put together. And so yes, flowcharting is literally using flowchart. In fact, this presentation I'm about to do here was made using flowchart in PowerPoint. So it really uses very basic symbolic descriptions. The piece we're going to flowchart is Ludwig von Beethoven's Für Elise, written in 1808. And it's a bagatelle in A minor. It's a solo piano work. You probably have heard it many times. And but you maybe have never seen it quite this way. This is going to be sort of a flowchart animation. So we're going to listen to the piece in its entirety, and we'll watch the flowchart as it progresses through. Here we go. So there we have it, analytical musical listening, and three different techniques for that approach. So it turns out you don't necessarily need to be able to read music notation or score notation. You can actually use various techniques, procedural listening, analytical listening, active listening, and of course flowcharting, to be able to discern and group together and come to a greater understanding both of the music of others that you're studying, as well as your own music as you're working on it in the creative process. So I do hope that these techniques are helpful to you, and I look forward to discussing them further in class.